So thanks to Sartorius to giving me this opportunity to present you about antibody drug conjugates. So today I'm not really going to focus on my own technologies, but try in a modest way to give you some insights on the antibody drug conjugates. So first of all, I have a question. I'd be interested if among the audience, the people who consider themselves as familiar with the antibody drug conjugates, can you please raise your hand? Okay, so one third. And among the people who have heard about ADCs, how many of you have heard positively about ADCs? And how many of you have heard negatively about ADCs? Okay, interesting. So you see, there are some people who heard negatively. Okay, good. So, to come back to the oncology space. So historically, the treatment paradigm that's been used to treat patients is a combination of different approaches. So you have a surgery, you have a radiotherapy, and then you had the chemotherapeutics, which consist of using highly cytotoxic, highly toxic compounds that are able to destroy the tumor. Okay, and then you had the emergence of targeted therapies, which included kinase inhibitors, for instance, or mainly, I would say, the antibodies. The limitations with both approaches, targeted therapies and chemotherapeutics, are the following. For the chemotherapeutics, it's probably the only treatment so far beyond the surgery that is able to effectively kill the tumor. Okay, but the problem is that it results in a systemic effect with a lot of side effects, and we can't control really where it really affects the body. On the other side, the targeted therapies have shown a lot of promises and successful results, but an antibody will never be able to fully destroy the tumor. That's the issue. It brings a lot of selectivity, specificity to the tumor, but we always need to combine that with the chemotherapeutics. And considering that, many years ago, people started to look at the antibody drug conjugate as a way to overcome the limitation of both approaches. So, in other words, if you look at the construct of an antibody drug conjugate, I would say it's probably the most sophisticated, the most complex way of drug delivery. Okay? Because actually, one can use the antibodies as a way to selectively target highly potent cytotoxic drugs, okay, against the tumor. And it results in two effects. First of all, you increase the selectivity and you decrease the toxicity of that compound. And above all, many things that people don't think of is that you increase the half-life, the exposure of the body to that drug. If you take one small chemical molecule, the half-life is about a few hours maximum. If you take the half-life of an antibody, it's several weeks. It can be up to 4 weeks. So by increasing the exposure of the body, by conjugating this agent, you end up having this agent being exposed to the body for 2 to 3 weeks. So by doing that, one can increase what we call the therapeutic window. So that's one of the main advantages of the antibody drug conjugate. So, what is the mechanism? So, you have to consider the antibody as a shuttle. Okay, so that's a shuttle which is able to selectively target the small toxic compound to the tumor. Okay, once it reaches the tumor, it will recognize a specific antigen, specific receptor, which means that you can't use any type of antibody. You need to use an antibody which is designed against an antigen which is expressed over the surface and that is able to internalize the ADC once there is a process of recognition. Once it's recognized, the whole ADC gets inside the cell and then there is a release of a cytotoxic agent. Okay? So, that's basically the mode of action, and the release results in the destruction of a target cell, okay? So far, we could consider that ADC is not a fancy thing. It's a validated technology. We have on the market for the time being, two ADCs, but three that have been approved. The Mylotarg has been the first one approved for Pfizer, and it's been withdrawn for reasons related to cardiotoxicity and toxicity stability of the ADC. But for the time being, we have these two ADCs. The first one has been Kadcyla, which is an extension of trastuzumab. So trastuzumab, Herceptin, if you know it, it's a blockbuster on breast cancer, okay? For women who are overexpressing the receptor HER2. So basically what Ross has done was to use the exact same antibody and to conjugate that to a toxic payload named dimethylmertensine-1, the DM1. And it became the trastuzumab mertensine. And basically, they use that Kadcyla on the patients which become resistant to trastuzumab. Okay, so ADC is a way also to overcome the resistance against the same type of antibody that is used for the same construct. And then we have Adcetris, which has been developed by Cytogenetics and which is co-commercialized with Takeda. So I really want to insist, it's not a fancy thing, and that's a hugely growing market with a lot of actors in the field. So in terms of opportunities, first of all, it's kind of a new treatment paradigm, because you can tackle the destruction of a tumor with different approaches. As I said before, you can increase the half-life of existing toxic compounds. Just one comment, when it comes to the construct of the ADC, some people are using are not really toxic payloads, they use what they call immunotoxin, which consists of large proteins, which are also very toxic. The reason why it had much less success than using small chemical molecules is because it has an effect in terms of immunogenicity. So over the last years, most of the companies which are focused in developing antibody drug conjugates are really focused on toxic payloads being small molecules. And when I talk about small molecules, it's really chemical molecules. So one of the other advantages is what I call the repositioning or the life cycle extension of existing antibodies or chemotherapeutics. I gave you the example of trastuzumab. It's a way to revive antibodies, and I'm also addressing that to you guys, you know, in case you had on some of your projects some antibodies that were completely not effective, but probably could be re-evaluated for an ADC application. Of course, it has to respond to some further specifications, but many organizations have been able to revive some antibodies that were not sufficiently effective to destroy the tumor, but can be used as a shutdown. And on the other hand, many organizations have been able to revive some compounds that they were considering as way too potent. Okay? And the beauty of the ADC field is that playing with the IP, with the patents, you can have one publicly available antibody, one publicly available and non-protected toxic payload, I mean toxic molecules, and end up with something that can be patent protected. Of course, there are some requirements in terms of inventivity issues, but at the end of the day, it's possible. And this is what Cytogenetics, one of the companies that I will name later, has been able to do, as well as Immunogen on the toxic payload side. So that's one of the good opportunities, okay? And the advantage is that you can do a lot of combinations. So I mentioned before, on the structure, you have the toxic payload, you have also the linker, and I'll come to it today, and then you have the antibody. And just being limited to that, you can have tens of different combinations and possibilities. So that creates a lot of opportunities, but also a lot of complexity and difficulty to make a decision. So, in terms of market, it represents a market of minimum $24 billion by 2024. As I said, two approved ADCs, more than 70 ADCs on clinical stage. And that's growing every month. We hear about new ADCs going on the pipeline. And that's a very dynamic field in terms of licensing transactions. Last week, there's been once again an announcement, Cytogenetics signing a deal of more than $1 billion with immunomedics on an ADC. In the beginning of last year, Avi has made the biggest acquisition of a startup named Stemcentrix, multi-billion dollars, just because they had ADCs. So it's a very dynamic field, and the reason why it's very dynamic is because on the landscape of ADC developers, you have a big pharma which are only interested to develop ADC as a drug, and when they need different technologies, they just pick up on the market what's available. So, and since it's a multi-component drug, that creates a lot of opportunities for transactions. So the key actors in the field, and I would probably rate Roche and mainly Genentech as part of Roche as the most innovating company in the field, but you have also Pfizer, Merck, Takeda, Sanofi, AbbVie, and Bayer in Germany as well, who are quite active in this field. So ADCs are very promising. It goes without saying. But in terms of challenges, that has raised many challenges. First of all, on the clinical aspect. So using a linker is not as easy as we could think, because there are issues in terms of stability. Okay? So a linker basically consists of a chemical structure that helps to bridge the toxic payload to the antibody. But you have to make sure that it remains sufficiently stable once it's circulating in the body, but you have also to make sure that it gets released at the right time and in the right place. And at the end of the day, even with the most advanced linkers, we still have issues in terms of off-target effect. So if somebody comes to you and tells you the ADC helps to perfectly target the tumor, that's wrong. It helps to more specifically target the tumor. But even with the most advanced linkers, we still have more than 40% off-target effect. So that's a reality. And that creates a challenge and also some doubts within the community. Is it really ADCs worth it? And in terms of payload, I mentioned that some people have used large peptidic protein size payloads, which were cytotoxic, but that has created a lot of immunogenicity issues. So that has also raised some concern, and that's the reason why, for instance, in the case of Avicenna Oncology, we are only focused on small molecules as toxic payload. And then what I call the drug-antibody ratio versus dose. So the DAR, the drug-antibody ratio consists of the number of payloads that can be conjugated per antibody, okay? The average, normally, when you have one payload to be conjugated, normally you can conjugate up to 4 maximum per antibody. If you get more, you have an aggregation effect, and you have, because most of the toxic payloads are very hydrophobic molecules, and they tend to, inside the antibodies, drug conjugates to aggregate together. So it's still an issue. And because we have only 1 to 4 payloads conjugated to the antibody, and because it's difficult for an ADC to reach the target and to get inside the cell, some studies have demonstrated that out of 10,000 toxic payload molecules, only one reaches the target. So at the end of the day, that's the reason why we need highly toxic molecules, okay? So just to give you an insight, if we consider a kinase inhibitor, it's at, in terms of cytotoxicity, we measure the IC50, it's at the micromolar, okay? And the lower, the higher is the potency. We are at the micromolar with a traditional targeted therapies. For such compounds, toxic payloads, to be eligible, they need to be at the picomolar. So in terms of log cytotoxicity and fold of cytotoxicity, they have to be way, 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 way higher. So also one of the other issues is to develop an ADC against an antigen which is not sufficiently expressed on the tumor cells, or an antigen that is sufficiently expressed on the tumor but doesn't internalize sufficiently. So the design and the selection of the antibody is a key success factor as well. And people really didn't take it into account in the beginning. They just said, okay, let's take this antibody. This antibody has been designed against a receptor that might work. Well, actually, the type of receptor and the rate of internalization of that receptor and the density of that receptor on the surface is a key success factor to make sure that the ADC gets inside the cell. And people learned that to their expenses and to the expense of the reputation of ADC. So in terms of technical challenges, many people have worked on innovating technologies, and I think in Sartorius you might have a good experience with that. When you want to scale up, then it becomes a mess. It's difficult, you know, to get to, I would say, optimal processes and cost-effective processes. So that's been some issues. The heterogeneity, the first generation of ADCs, like the one from Kite Sala, from one ADC to the other, in the same bulk, you could have completely different DAR. And that creates an issue from a regulatory perspective and from the patient perspective, because the FDA and the EMA legitimately would say, well, you know, how can we ensure that we have the same product given to each and every patient? So the DAR has been an issue on the first generation of ADCs. Then it's been overcome with a site specificity, but by wanting to do site specificity, and I will explain that afterwards, you end up with other technical issues, and then the construct optimization. Apart from a couple of companies in the world, most of the companies which are innovating in the field, they are only concentrated on one aspect of it. In my case, I have identified, you know, new toxic payloads, but how am I going to optimize that payload with a proper linker and with a proper antibody? And that raises a lot of technical issues that needs to be answered. So, mixed impressions, and that's why I asked the audience, you know, if some have heard positively and some negatively about the ADCs. On one side, new treatment, paradigm, promising alternative, and on the other side, and I got even people that I discussed with who said, yeah, ADCs, it's too crowded, too many issues, Katsaila went just on one tiny indication, the resistance to trastuzumab, and it's been tested on over indication, gastric cancer, and it didn't work, and we think that ADC is not working. Well, actually, Katsaila has not been able to raise the level of market expected just because it's the first generation. And that's been exactly the same story with antibodies. 10 to 15 years ago, we had the first generation of antibodies. It raised a lot of promises, marine antibodies, and then all of a sudden a lot of immunogenicity issues. And then it went through a down phase, and nobody wanted to hear about that. And then with the new generation of humanized and chimeric antibodies, it went up. And I think in the ADC we are exactly in that phase, where many actors are coming up with new approaches, new technologies, able to overcome the issues that the first generation are exposed to. But the problem is that in the media, and even in the literature, many people will hear more about the technical issues without knowing that these technical issues are being overcome. And if you take the exact the example of Roche, for instance, on their pipeline, all the following ADCs which are in development are completely different in terms of construct compared to the first one which is in the market, which means that they are taking into account the technical and clinical challenges that they've been exposed to. So, when people are talking about ADCs, you will hear a lot of words. People are talking about linkers, I'm working in linkers, but what is a linker? How does it work? How is it built? I think that one of the issues that we are seeing also in the technical challenges that I mentioned before and also the clinical challenges is a proper understanding of an ADC construct. Okay? How do we build an ADC and what are the different, what I call, building blocks? So traditionally, when people were describing, you know, an ADC, they were talking about what I call the vehicle, which can be an antibody, but that can be over type of entities. And they were talking about the linker, the overall linker, and then the toxic payload. And in this space, it's quite a mess. I mean, you see a lot of actors saying, yeah, we are in the field of linkers, but actually they are just on this, or they are just on both, or some are just on this. So my goal today is just to go through each and every building block and tell you what is the state of the art, so that if one day you're exposed or you're likely to be involved in a project related to ADC, you'll have a better understanding of what's going on. So I will start with a vehicle. I call that the vehicle. So the vehicle is what brings the selectivity and increase what brings first the selectivity to the target. So the most famous one is the antibody. And among the community of ADC developers, some have used different isotypes. And what do I mean with different isotypes? Depending on the type of isotype, you could decide that the antibody by itself has an effect or no effect against the target. If you take trastuzumab on its own, it has some effect on the target. But some people might say, no, I don't want the antibody to have an effect against the target. And we call that the ADCC or the CDC, which is an effect on activating the immune system to destroy, or the antibody to destroy by itself the end target. Okay? So some people might say, I don't want to have an antibody against this tumor that will have an effect, so I will use an IgG which doesn't have any activity. So that's the first variation that people can see, and that has an impact on the mechanistic of the ADC. And then depending on the wishes of the people, for instance, you could decide to work on a complete antibody or to work on a fragment of an antibody fragment. And some people are working also on different type of antibodies, such as ablinks, for instance. They work on they call that nanobodies, which are antibodies from camelid, and they want to develop that with conjugates. So that's the first approach. Then the second approach is what we call antibody mimic. These are not anymore antibodies, but try to mimic the behavior of the antibody and to overcome the limitation of antibody. I would say the main limitation of an antibody are the following. First of all, an antibody has difficulties to enter into solid tumors. There is what we call a barrier entry effect. Once an antibody gets next to the tumor, they get all of them, the ADCs, in the entry of the tumor, and they can't really diffuse effectively. So that's one of the first issues. Second issue, we can't use the antibodies, for instance, for glioblastoma. Yesterday there has been some words about that, that it's a very dreadful indication. So glioblastoma, the antibody can't cross the blood-brain barrier, and that has some limitations, so that's why some people are using antibody mimics. And also antibody mimics sometimes can end up being more cost effective in terms of construct and manufacturing perspective. So in terms of over vehicles, engineered proteins, some people are using small molecules. So like yesterday, there's been the cubosome that's been used with the agonist of folate receptor. And there are a few companies only dedicated to that. Okay, and then some are looking at nanoparticles. At the end of the day, monoclonal antibodies remain the king of the game. And like one the vice president of Seattle Genetics was saying, it's still the worst, but still the best to use. It's the most validated. It has the best, probably still the highest level of selectivity, and by far the highest half-life. So, and even myself, when I'm looking and I'm developing payloads, so I'm interested to look at all of them. And so far, by default, the antibody remains the best. And even, you know, the replacement of antibodies with other vehicles would be challenged in terms of selectivity and or half-life. So that's the vehicle. Now, once you work on, you have selected your vehicle, you say you want to start with an antibody. And let's be focused only on the ADC, the antibody drug conjugate. You need to fix, to hook the linker properly to the antibody, okay? And historically, when people started to work on ADCs, they use the natural amino acids which are on the surface of the antibodies. And the first generation consisted of using the lysine as a point of fixation. And since the lysine is widely and heterogeneously distributed over the surface, we ended up with the first generation of ADCs with heterogeneous DAR, as I mentioned before. Okay? So what the people said, well, in the community, they said, well, if we can't have any control on the DAR because of the lysine, let's try over amino acids. So they went to the cysteine. Cysteine second generation, which is more site-specific, because normally, as accessible, you have between 1 to 8 cysteine, which are accessible to be used. I would say the most accessible on the surface, 8 to 1 cysteine to be used. So it reduces the level of heterogeneity, and it brings more site specificity, because these cysteines are on the disulfide bridges between the chains, intra-chain and interchain bridges, okay? And then there's been a lot of innovating companies who decided to work on what we call non-natural amino acids. So far, we listed up to 70 non-natural amino acids that have been engineered either on the upstream side, so by genetic engineering, or on the downstream side by doing post-translational modification. One example is the Thiomap from Roche, which consists of using a selenocysteine instead of a cysteine in order to have a more stable and a more site-specific and a very constant DAR. The DAR is 2.0, no matter what happens. So here we have seen, you know, a lot of improvement into that, but still I would say the cysteine second generation is probably the most established and the most used. So here it's about the handling site. So you see here once again, the handling site is part of a vehicle, and one can't make a consideration about the vehicle without considering the handling site. And many companies, when you look at the companies working on this, they would pretend, I mean not pretend, but they would claim that they work on the linkers. Well, actually they work only on this. Okay? Then you have some other type of companies and organizations who are working on the handle. So on the linker structure, because the way it works, when you want to conjugate an antibody to a toxic payload, you take the payload, you conjugate by coupling, by chemistry coupling to the linker, and you have then the toxic payload linker structure, and then you do a final bioconjugation. And this final bioconjugation between the toxic payload construct and the vehicle, in that case the antibody, is done via a handle. And historically, what people have used are the maleimide, and I'm not going to enter into the chemistry. Maleimide is still extensively used, but that has raised a lot of issues in terms of stability. The maleimide is a reactive molecule, that's why we can use that to do the pharmacological conjugation, but at the end of the day, it results within a... I have to close the... Okay, so we have a maleimide. And then the new actors are on the maleimide analog, and then on maleimide substitute. So here we see, you know, some innovation in the field. Then on the spacer. So the spacer as a goal, it has as a goal to increase to optimize the ADC and to increase to decrease the hydrophobicity related to the toxic payload. And that's one important aspect, because many people talk about that. It's the trigger. The difference between a cleavable and a non-cleavable ADC. The first generation of ADC from Roche is a non-cleavable. What does it mean? It means that it doesn't have a trigger. It means that when it gets inside the cell, there is no cleavage mechanism. It's the overall construct, linker plus toxic payload, that destroys the cell. But the most used application is the cleavable. And depending on what we call the type of trigger, we could end up with different type of cleavage. Either a cleavage which is triggered via enzymes which are inside the cell and which are known to be overexpressed in tumors, in that case protease, cathepsin B, and we use as a structure for the trigger the dipeptide. Valine citrulline is by far the most used trigger in the industry. And then you have other type of trigger which are either pH sensitive or redox sensitive. So in terms of spacer, self-immolative spacer, not so much innovation as well. So with a payload, if you look at the field of ADCs, in the field of if you look at the pipeline of the ADCs under development, up to 80% are just with two payloads, the same mode of action. The same mode of action, tubulin inhibitors. So that creates a real need and demand from the industry and from the clinical community to have new generation of payload. The two actors working on that are Seattle Genetics and Immunogen. And when you look at the field of ADCs, the majority of the pharma companies are interested to develop ADCs, and then the second majority are mainly on the linkers and some building blocks of the linkers. And when it comes to the payload, there is a monopoly of mainly two companies. And the few ones which are developing payloads, they just keep that for themselves. And that creates a real demand. So that's the reason why I created Avicenna Oncology, a startup located in Basel, created in 2014. And really the mission was to fill that gap. How? By identifying and developing new generation of toxic payloads for conjugate applications. And really the focus was new mode of action, improved potency against the benchmark, chemical tractability, patent protected, and ability to conjugate the compound. So, the last slide, I promise. Where we also tend to have a different approach, and that's been also one of the issues in the development of ADC. People who were developing ADCs always started with the antibody. They said, let's start with the antibody and let's take a payload as a bullet that can destroy any type of tumor. It turns out to be, from our perspective, an irrelevant approach, because at the end of the day, what's going to destroy the tumor is the payload. So a deep understanding of the mechanistic of a payload, taking that into consideration, has to change the way we design the ADC. A pharma company will start with the ADC, the antibody, and have an antibody-driven, antibody-centric design of the ADC. We believe that we have another approach, which should be payload-centric design of ADC. We take a payload, we characterize deeply in which subpopulation of patients it's the most effective, okay? And there's been a presentation yesterday about, you know, patient stratification based on the genomic profile and the level of responsiveness. And based on that, we could say we know this payload is much more effective and less likely to be subject to a mechanism of resistance in this and this and this subpopulation of patients. Let's take antibodies which are targeting these indications, starting from the payload. And that's all in the field of precision medicine, which is also extensively growing. So, to summarize, the key success factor when people design an ADC is good understanding of each potential construct, understanding the therapeutic implications, and if any people are involved here in the development of ADC, please involve clinicians as early as possible. Okay, don't wait too long, because the understanding of the cancer biology, the understanding of the pathobiology will have an impact on the effectiveness of the ADC. And a shift towards more payload-centric rather than antibody-centric ADC design. And I want to say that in terms of needs, although we see a lot of innovating actors on the handle and the handle side, there is still a need of innovation for new generation of triggers and new payloads. And with that, I would like to thank you for your patience.